About 3 years ago, I went to Harvard for a visit. And while there, you know, doing some stuff with the Berkman Center over at the law school, I ran into Professor Ogletree, and he was having a dinner or an evening gathering and invited myself, and I believe it was the director of rehab, Guy Campbell, to come and see what was happening. And so when we went in, it was a room, you know, kind of like this room, but, you know, the tables were just like along the edge and everybody was just like sitting around. And we're just having open conversation. But what was amazing for me is that the people that were in the room were just so powerful. I'm talking about, and it was all black people. We're talking about lawyers and judges and, I mean, people that were just doing amazing things. And for me, that was just a very, very powerful thing to be a part of. So what I actually wanted to do and what I've been thinking about since then is how can we get something like that going in Jamaica, where we just kind of get together and have conversations where I know that you're working on your thing and you're working on your thing and I'm working on my thing, and we will support each other in a networking kind of environment or networking kind of vibe, but at the same time, we're still trying to figure out, should try to find a collective that we can all buy into, that we can all support. And so I thought about how we would do this, and I thought the best way to do it is just to gather a bunch of people together who I felt, you know, were, you know, just doing good things and had good intentions, but probably just needed a little bit of push here and there. And not only would we feed off of each other in terms of, you know, networking among each other, but I've been speaking, you know, with Professor Nesson, and mentioned it also to Professor Ogletree about the whole idea of putting together this group, and then we would have professors, you know, from Harvard in different disciplines that would then mentor this group in whatever it is that we chose to do. So Professor Nesson signed on, Professor Ogletree signed on. And I'm not even sure what we're going to be doing. I'm not sure where it's going to be going. But I just wanted us to have some kind of conversation tonight, so we can probably, everybody just kind of throw some ideas down, and then maybe we can come up with exactly how we would want to move this process. And so I basically selected people that I've been associated with that I thought were powerful and that could add stuff. and that could add stuff to me, and that I could share stuff with them as well. So hence the people that are in the room, and some people are probably still on their way, and so on and so forth. One of the things that I thought about, you know, in putting this idea together, is that we need to take a look at Jamaica, you know, in terms of where we are, but also where we're coming from. And I think the story of the Maroons is a story that we really need to understand, and then to see where we are and understand why we are where we are, and see how we can kind of move things along by simply just understanding some of the fundamental things that were done to make us look and feel the way that we do. I think if you take a look at, and I'll just give you, in a sense, a quick synopsis of my understanding of the whole thing. When we were colonized, and so slavery was here and all that kind of stuff was happening. Then the Maroons, basically they ran off into the hills and started their own community. When it first started out, the Arawaks being here, then the Spaniards came and, you know, got rid of the Arawaks, and then the British came and put out some serious punishment on the Spaniards, and then, you know, slavery and then black people coming from Africa and all that kind of stuff, and more slavery, the black people started to rebel. And so, you know, I think it was a mixture of the Spaniards and the Africans, you know, that in a sense formed the Maroons. I could be wrong on that, but somebody in the room is an historian, I'm sure. And so when they ran off in the hills and they had their own communities, what happened is that the slaves, when they were brought here from Africa, whenever the slaves decided to run away, what would happen is that the Maroons would welcome them. And so the Maroons, in a sense, became a hole in the bottom of the British cup. And so the British was always fighting with the Maroons. And I mean, it was like a war that lasted over some 300 years. And it seemed that the Maroon was winning this war, but one thing was evident is that the Maroons could just never get started. because as soon as they built their community, as soon as they got something arranged, it's like, here comes the British with their guns and their cannons. So at one point, the British, you know, went to the Maroons and said, look, you know, we're not doing each other any justice. You, our slaves are running away, and you're taking them. We're coming up here with our guns and our bombs and our cannons, and we're constantly fighting with you. I think we should form, let's get to some kind of an agreement. And the Maroons, they thought about it for a very long time. And they thought about the fact that, okay, I mean, we can continue to fight this war, but then our children will never get an opportunity to really settle down and go to school and be educated and all these different kinds of stuff. We'll never be able to really plan crops and sustain it because the British are always coming and they're always terrorizing whatever it is that we have. So they got to the point where they said, you know what, we're going to sign this treaty. And so they signed the treaty with the British. But what the treaty, signing treaty, what it meant was that the Maroons now became the slave police. And so when the slaves ran away, a part of the deal was that you, whatever your community looked like now, you could keep your community that way. But whenever the slaves run away and they come up into this area, we wanted to capture the slaves and give them back to us. So they became the slave police. So what ended up happening is that at one point in time, you know, it was very difficult to control it. And so here it is that the British, they were constantly being the ones in the field whipping the slaves. But with this new form, not only did the Maroons became the slave police, but other persons, other blacks on the plantation, they actually became the ones that were out in the field and whipping the slaves. And the slave master, the British, they just took a step up on the porch and they could watch things from there. And then later on, they took a step further in the house. And then there was a slave master, which was now a black guy, that was now sitting on the porch watching the other black guys whipping the slaves in the field. And so eventually, in 1962, when Jamaica got its independence, and I use the word got because we never fought for it, we never did anything, so we got our independence. The British says, look, whatever laws and stuff that we have in place now must remain in place. So you can do whatever, you can now run your country, but you're gonna run it with our laws. And so in taking a look at the kind of things that we do now, the way our judicial system works, the way our education system works, and even the way in which we practice religion, it's similar, or not even similar, it's exactly how the British left it. So we have not really done anything. So there's a big question in my mind, and something that we've been discussing over the longest while, is that how does Jamaica get to a point where it is totally in control of its affairs? And the only way I can see that happening is that Jamaica needs to reconstitute itself. So we need to take a look at all that, you know, was here prior to the British leaving. And even though we might bring it to the table, question it, and still agree and make the same thing, and still continue to do the same things, but then we would have had some kind of referendum, had some kind of dialogue around it, and then it would have been now our choice, as opposed to something just being thrown upon us. And I think if we should, you know, study the history in that regard, then, I mean, that's something that we can take a look at in terms of how we are the way we are. And why is it that, I mean, in our courts, we're still wearing those white wigs? I don't get it. People as dark as I am, and we're wearing these white British wigs, and we're dressing up in these hot robes and doing certain things that it's just not befitting to the Caribbean. So I'm wondering if we, as Jamaicans, had the opportunity to choose, would we choose the justice system to look the way that it does? And even the way in which we, the uniforms and the stuff like that, in terms of our children going to school and whatever, I'm not saying it's good or it's bad, but given the chance, would we have chosen that? The way our police officers operate, would we have chosen that? And so everything, I think all of those things are things that could be put on the table, and we could question all of those things and decide, you know, whether or not, you know, these are the things that we want to go with. So for me, that is one of the conversations that I would like for us to have. You know, but there's a ton of different conversations that I'd like for us to have. So this is not really about me imposing what it is that's important to me on this group, but more or less the group that's kind of just like, oh, this is important to me, the group might have other ideas of things that might be important to them. And we just have conversations around it. and see how we can just, you know, assist in terms of moving this country along.